Join us for Bible study each Wednesday at 7 p.m. right here on Facebook Live. We're in this together. Please submit your prayer request using the link that will be provided in the comments area of this broadcast. Thank you for your help and support of our ministry. Please sow your seed using the giving link that will appear in the comments section of the broadcast, or you can use e-giving on your cell phone.
Hello, I'm Byron Broussard, and it's Juneteenth. That the children will be able to plug into the Juneteenth experience and celebration, and it will help to start the dialogue about slavery, how bad it was, how great it was for it to end, and the long journey towards something better for us as a people.
A big showing this afternoon at a Juneteenth march in Detroit. The goal here, making sure black voices are heard by the government. People march through the streets, stopping at the Power to the People mural, which is in Spirit Plaza. The entire crowd took a knee with fists in the air. A voter registration drive was also held during the march, and people were encouraged to fill out their census forms.
Thank you for watching Shake the Nations. Please join us as we recite the Love Center vision, mission, and intentional strategy.
Our vision statement, crossing all the lines to reach all the people with the healing gospel of Jesus Christ. Our mission statement, we are a Christian church. Jesus Christ has issued to us a mandate for ministry to all the people, especially the poor and the lost. Our church seeks to identify and design a healing ministry to meet the needs of the total man, mind, body, and spirit, thereby making active disciples. And our intentional strategy, a commitment to the Word of God as the source of truth, a commitment to prayer, a commitment to praise and worship, a commitment to fellowship, a commitment to evangelism based upon Acts 2, 42 through 47.
Join us for Bible study each Wednesday at 7 p.m. right here on Facebook Live.
Thank you for your help and support of our ministry. Please sow your seed using the giving link that will appear in the comments section of the broadcast, or you can use e-giving on your cell phone.
Juneteenth is a deeply emotional moment for enslaved people because for decades, for centuries, enslaved people prayed for, hoped for, fought for in the form of slave rebellions, running away, bought their freedom when they could. And if you read slave narratives, if you listen to spirituals from the era of slavery, you know that enslaved people longed for freedom. This was something that had been hoped for, but many believe may never come.
Thank you again for watching Shake the Nations.
In the beginning, it was kind of hard. I had father figures, but not a actual father.
My father was a quiet, soft-spoken man, but he was stern. When he said something, you better believe that he meant it. And he wouldn't hold any punches. He would tell you the truth.
Their guidance really affected me being a father because I wanted to have the same relationship or greater with my children.
I really didn't have any idea of what it was like to be a father other than seeing the men in my neighborhood growing up.
It's been great because I'm totally opposite of the father that I had growing up, my absent father, but I'm actually present in both of my daughters' life. And that's helped me shape my life and shape my life around me.
My sister and I, he was relaxing in the den, and we just decided to lift him up in his chair and sit him outside on the porch. And we did that and got a big laugh out of it. He thought it was pretty funny because, you know, two half-grown children playing with their father like that, you know, it's not very many moments like that to share.
Even now, it makes me pretty emotional. My senior year in high school, we had our first game in the Georgia Dome. And my parents were up in Maryland. And of course, I was there playing the game in Atlanta. They drove 600 miles to watch me play.
And so I went to my dad and I said, Dad, I said, it's like, I'm getting ready to go leave home, go to the military. The one thing that my dad said, he said, don't forget where home is.
To look back on from birthday, from the day of birth until now, and see how being a father has helped me grow as a better man.
You know, that process and then me having my second child, which is 2 years old, and us bonding as a family, made the difference for us, you know, pretty much coming together and making the difference in all of our lives.
Yeah, when me and my youngest son were talking, I was actually apologizing to him for not being there earlier on in his years. He told me that he understood the things that I was going through, and he told me that he loved me. He told me that you're still alive and we can go on from here. To make God your first response, always.
Especially with my son, you know, use those instincts that the Heavenly Father has given you in order to look into situations and try to get away from them.
By right, we have the right to be treated equal, hands down. But you have to make sure that you don't get caught up in some of the other things that are going on. And we try to keep it positive and do it the right way.
And I make him aware that there's nothing wrong with his skin. Be proud that God blessed you to be who you are. Embrace that. And that time is going to come. Things are going to get better where his skin won't be a target.
Not teaching them race differences or prejudices, because race differences and prejudices will be known, I believe, to them just as a result of growing up.
Even though it's Father's Day, my mother gave us one of the greatest gifts that she could have ever given us when she introduced us to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
If it wasn't for my faith, I really don't think I would be a father. I probably would be somebody's daddy, long lost in the wind.
Being able to have God as the center, and that is all we know and we can trust on, that we have to depend on God, because, you know, things can go, come and go today or tomorrow.
Even while I was enjoying the good times, especially during the troubled times, that I would be okay in dealing with my children or my family.
That word is very, very important to me, because in this day and time when our very persons, our very character, our very existence is being attacked, that word helps me to keep my head lifted on a daily basis.
I didn't even understand that I was a king. You know, I knew I was saved, but I didn't understand what it meant to take on that role.
He's a provider, he's a protector, he's a giver of wisdom and substance to his to those that's in his kingdom.
Your kingdom is not a small defined area. It's everywhere. It's all around us. Therefore, you have to be on point doing the things you're supposed to do in order for other people to look and see you.
But I'm thinking a warrior, somebody leads, putting others before yourself, and just taking a stance on you and your family and the people all around you.
We look at it and people look at it and say, well, you're just men. We're not just men. We're a family, and we all take care of each other. I've said it numerous times to numerous guys that any man can be a child or a children's dad. But to be a father means you're gonna always go the extra mile.
He has hopes and dreams and desires for his children, believing that their life would be better than his.
I used to hear the term about marinade. Everybody's family to have a different marinade. And once you marinate in that and know your specific role as a father, you would learn how to deal with it in any given situation.
I wouldn't trade any moment that I've had with them for anything. It's simply the greatest gift ever.
The preaching of the gospel brings the heart and mind of God to the people who need to know and understand His will. God takes the yielded vessels and uses them to point us to paths of hope and change for the better. In times like these, we need to hear a voice that will speak truth to power and love to the lost. Let's be blessed together right now with Pastor Byron L. Broussard.
I can't say enough how blessed I am to be a part of this ministry, this Love Center Atlanta Fellowship. I'm Byron Broussard. I'm here in Atlanta, Georgia. We're inside of the sanctuary of Love Center Atlanta on our Atlanta campus. It's a blessing to be alive today. And the world, America in particular, celebrates Father's Day on today. And as you've just gotten finished listening to and watching men, these men are part of a very special fellowship here at the church called Just Brothers, and the acronym stands J-U-S-T, Jesus Ultimately Saves and Transforms Brothers. You can't make the things up that the gentleman just got finished sharing, nor can you manufacture the level of transparency and intimacy that we share. It blesses me. We bless each other. It's rare. It's beautiful. And it will be respected. Happy Father's Day to every man who tries, who is about to try, who has tried and failed and is ramping up to do it all over again. I thank God for the fact that you know that God is going to help you this time and that things are going to be as they need to be. With man, it may be impossible, but with God, all things really are possible. Now to the women and the children who need a father. Today's message is, I pray, going to be very clear, and I need for you to have an open mind and to lean in, because when I go to this familiar story, there are some insights that we'll draw out of it that are not necessarily in agreement with 2020 mindsets and mentality. Well, that's enough. Let's go to the scripture. Luke 15 says this at the end of the story that's been called and come to be known as the prodigal son. Verse 24 says, "For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And they began to be merry. Merry is an old-fashioned word for happy. Happy is the way they ended up, but happy isn't the way the story started. And the middle and almost at the end weren't happy either. Here's what the journey in the text takes us to. First of all, there was a man who had two sons. One was a little older than the other. They weren't twins. And the older son was a homebody. He was stable. He worked around the property. The old man had managed by the grace of God to really be blessed. It was a powerful situation. And it may not be a matchup to the constant story of poverty and rags to riches that we've grown accustomed to, a completely dysfunctional household that many of us are struggling to deal with ourselves, having come out of them, our children being a part of them. But this one had stability and prosperity in it, but stability and prosperity does not make us immune to difficult situations. Let's pray. God, bless this word. Bless the people who hear it. Make us all better because of it. That's who you are and what you do for us. We call on you now. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, the story starts, oddly enough, with the young boy wanting to leave. He's smelling himself and feeling himself, and the curfew is too tight. The rules and the regulations of daddy's house are just stifling to him. He's probably met a girl, She probably told him he looked good. And he realizes that there are some possibilities in his inheritance. So prematurely, he approaches his father and says, look, I can't do it over here anymore. Old man, give me the portion of goods that falls to me now. Now, before I try to touch that and develop that at all, let's deal with a principle called patriarchal mentality. It is in complete disharmony and disagreement with what has become known in our day and time as toxic masculinity. The old man that's being approached about giving a piece of his inheritance in this text has been a man's man for a long time. I don't even see the feminine influence in this particular decision. How in the world is he going to give money out of his household without his woman's approval? The text is in disharmony and disagreement. Patriarchy assumes ultimate responsibility. It does not move inherent disrespect or mistreatment of a woman. It simply says that she is among the many things at the top of the list, albeit, but among the many things that a man's man has to concern himself with taking care of. This son that approached his father approached a man that had taken care of him, had taken care of his mama, had taken care of his brother, had taken care of the household all his life. So when it came time to strike out, he needed to come to the source and resource bin that had taken care of him. All he knew to do when it was time to go outside the confines of his household was go to his daddy and ask for what he needed. I'll put a pin there before I mess around and get excited and mess up the whole sermon. But I want for us to consider what this young boy is doing. He wants to go and find himself. So he takes a journey, a far country journey, a long way from home, a long way from the established patriarchal rules and constructs of a household, a long way from what the Jewish term mishpacha, a family of accountability, install standards. Listen, you are a Smith, you are Jones, you are Johnson, you are Broussard. You don't embarrass us. You don't act like that. You've got to stand up and live up to the name that represents our family. He took a long journey trying to get away from all of that. Hallelujah. But you got to understand, if you are what you are and what you are is established in grace and righteousness, nowhere you go can you get away from who you are. Well, he went, he left, he parted, he clowned, he spent his inheritance on that journey in that far country. He acted every other way than the way that he'd been raised to act. He could have lost his life. As a matter of fact, at the end of the story, the first thing we read just now was, my son was dead. That actually equates loss, not physically dead, but dead in trespasses and dead in sin and dead in foolishness and dead in poor decisions and dead surrounded by other little clueless monkeys who were simply there as long as the party lasted. And it's told in the rest of the text because as soon as the money got funny and the women went away, he had to get a job in a hog pen. Well, far country messed him up. But after that, he comes to himself because you got to understand where there's been seed poured into a situation, the harvest will come eventually. If something has been poured into you, if you are a father that has taken the time to pour into your seed, your offspring, they may go off. Hallelujah. Train up a child. Train, not just teach, train. What's the difference, preacher? They sound just alike. Train is different than teach. If you teach, you get the information and you put the information in front of the child. And if the child receives it or accepts it, then it's wonderful, and you clap for them and you give them treats, gifts, presents, rewards, and you tell them how wonderful they are. But when you're training, you don't care whether they receive or like it or not, because it's something that they have to have when they are not in your presence. It's something they're going to need when you're not around to fix it for them. It's something you're going to need when daddy's not around to give you the money to clean up your mess or to deal with your difficult situation. And so train up a child in the way that they should go. When they're old, even though they taste different things, and even though they try different stuff, even though they smoke that or snort that or lay with this one or lay with that one, when they are older, they have the capacity to come to themselves. Oh, bless his holy name. Sometimes it's a tight fight with a short stick. Sometimes it's touch and go, and it's very difficult. But the patriarchal construct sets up a model wherein a man makes a man. And that man is going to go out and explore. That man is going to get into some trouble. That man is going to deal in difficulty. Their mental muscles are strengthened in difficulty. Their emotional muscles are strengthened in difficulty. When you got to pay a bill and you don't have the money to pay for it, hallelujah, what comes to you is oftentimes a result of what was poured into you before you left and got in trouble. I'll never forget being in Atlanta, Georgia, 17 years old, broke as Cooter was when Hattie, his girlfriend, died. I went to the plasma unit, and I got $10, along with my friends. They got $10, and when 10 of us had $10, we had $100. We were rich. We went to the store, bought some ground beef and some manwich. Cut up an onion, put it in the pot. And that was the closest thing we could have to a feast. You got to understand that we came from some men who understood that life wouldn't always be pleasant, pretty, or sweet. They taught us how to do what we needed to do. I remembered Spam sandwiches that my daddy had fried up for me. Made me think it was wonderful. I remember having to make do with what got. When we went to the refrigerator and what we were looking for wasn't quite there, I want you to understand that there is a quality exchange and transfer that takes place from a man to their child in giving them some tools to deal with dilemmas and difficulties in life. Well, he went to the far country, got in trouble and lost his inheritance. But then in verse 17, the scripture tells us he came to himself. Oh my God. Well, what kind of trauma do you experience when you look around you and realize what a mess you made out of your life situation? How embarrassing is it when you come from somewhere and you look around and you're laying in nothing and nowhere? Well, what does it feel like when you realize you've been tricked? Denzel, help me. You've been hoodwinked. You've been bamboozled. You've been led astray. You've been run amok. And you thought you were smart. You thought you were smarter than that old man who was placing restrictions on you, just trying to hold you back and hold you down. You thought you were smart when you were feeling yourself and wanted to sow your oats, and that old man just didn't understand. But thanks be to God. You know, it's amazing. I've seen graphs about it. They say when you're a teenager, you think your parents are just stupid and have no sense. When you get in your 20s and you get out on your own, you're embarrassed to call them and tell them about all the life lessons that are flashing before your eyes when you hear their voice. And you're in a stupid situation. When you get to be 30, it doesn't matter. You go back home and you say, teach me some more. This is a cold, cruel world, and I want to be more like you if indeed you were blessed to have a father who was stable, who was godly, who tried to do right, who came home at night who took care of his wife, his children, his household, who tried to make sure at his own personal sacrifice that you were all right. Oh, bless the Lord. The patriarchal model, patriarch, responsible party. Hallelujah. Taking responsibility for the mishpacha, the family. Oftentimes, the patriarch is the one, not only in the immediate family, but in the extended family that is the anchor, the rock, the person, the go-to person in difficulty and dilemma. And this father in this text seems to be set up just that way. Well, the son spent the money, and he comes to himself, and when he comes to himself, he's in a hog pen because he had to take a job slopping hogs. Has anybody in here ever had to do the equivalent of slopping hogs? I don't know what your hog slopping job was, but mine was working at the liquor store. And it came to the point where my Sunday school vacation Bible school trained self was selling half pints of old Mr. Boston gin at the liquor store with a license to preach in my pocket, selling bumpy face, and they called it Easy Jesus, cheap E&J brandy at the liquor store. And it came to the point, God is a wonder. Look, somebody holler at somebody else and tell them God is everywhere. He found his young, clueless preacher in the liquor store and spoke to his spirit when the liquor store owner tried to make him sell some to a person who was already drunk. That's it. I know right from wrong, and I may have hit this situation. I'm in this cesspool or hog pen of a personal situation. I don't lose it. I don't tune out if you're drinking. I don't tune out. There's nothing inherently evil, wrong, or devilish about the alcohol. It's what it does in you and what you do with it. But for me, that was a hog pen. For an anointed vessel that God birthed to preach the gospel, selling liquor to people who were already drunk was my hog pen experience. It was something that I just wasn't born to do. I walked out of that store, and I didn't know how I was going to get the next money, but what I did know is that I served a God who was able. I came to myself. I don't know, if you would take a few minutes and think of your personal experience, you may not want to be as transparent as I am. You see, I'm protected by the blood, I'm anointed by the Lamb, and I'm empowered by the Holy Ghost. And so it doesn't sweat. You know, I don't sweat transparency. It's a tool to be used to bless people who are currently in the situation that God has taken me out of. Oh, bless his holy name. He came to himself. And if you're in a hog pen, let me talk to you. You don't have to be young to be lost. You don't have to be a boy or a baby to be dead in trespasses and sins. You might be the potential patriarch. You might be the father. And your son, hallelujah, may be waiting for you to get yourself together so you can be a real father to him. And your hog pen doesn't have to be broke, busted, and without the means. You may be bawling and shot calling, but you are a terrible tragedy of a father right now. You're spending all your substance on women who don't really want you, and you have no covenant with. The marriage bed is undefiled, and you're out in the street. Hallelujah, trying to play that old yellow player's card, you need to turn it in. Your babies are at home waiting for their daddy to be a real father to them. And so I don't know what your hog pen experience is, and I don't know how old you are while you're experiencing it, but what I do know is you can come to yourself. Let's check it out. What happens when you come to yourself? Is life almost over and you have to live as a second-class citizen for the rest of your life? No, the Bible says that when he came to himself, this is the revelation God gave him. He said, in my Father's house, even the servants have enough to eat and then some to spare. And I'm out here as smart as I am, as blessed as I am, with a pedigree, with people who love me, I'm out here with nothing to eat. I'm about to die because I'm hungry. I've attached myself to people who are making fun of me. They laugh at me when I come to my job. I smell like my job. I smell like a hog pen. I feel like a pig in slop. He came to himself. And let me explain. Listen. A major part of your battle this morning is coming to yourself. I don't care what you smell like when you come to yourself. I don't care what just came out of your mouth when you come to yourself. It doesn't matter what you just got finished smoking when you come to yourself. It doesn't matter who you just slept with when you come to yourself. The fact is that God loves you enough to shake you so that you can have a part two. And you can testify about your part one. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. Weeping, it might last for the night, but joy will come in the morning. But you got to make it through the night. Hold on. When he came to himself, he thought about his daddy. And his heart, his mind, his eyes, and his footsteps turned toward home. Oh, what a blessing. I just want to touch that for a little while. It may not be 18,000 square feet, but it's home. It may not be fly, but it's home. It may not be on Better Homes and Gardens, but it's home. And if God has blessed you with somebody who went through what they went through and ascended past their socioeconomic dilemma and difficulty and built you a home, made a place of comfort and sanctuary and peace for you to call home, and it still exists, and you're out in the street with people who don't love you, don't know God, and don't care about you, when you wake up, go home. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Go home. You might be ashamed, but go home. You got egg on your face, but go home. You're embarrassed, but go home. You stink, but go home. You're high, you're drunk, but go home. You're nasty, but go home. Go home. And his father, when he turned his footsteps toward home, his daddy, his papa, his old man, when he went home, check this out. You would think that he'd be like, messed up my family name. Who you think he is? Oh, it might have been a night or two like that. He's human. Patriarchs and fathers are human. Anger is a part of being a human being. And masculinity often expresses anger in venting. There may be a word or two used that you can't use in the Sunday school classroom. But you can't stop a real man from loving his seed. There's nowhere my child can go. Nothing that they can do. No failure, no accident, no mistake, no intentional thing done that can stop me from loving them, because God called me to be a steward of their lives until I die. I had two children, one of them going to heaven now, and I'm a steward of her legacy, and she's going to be with the Lord until I die, until I sleep. I'm responsible for everything that has to do with the seed that has come out of my loins. God did that. That's God's arrangement. You can't stop a real father from loving the children. The Bible says that when he was a long way off, that might be your story today. You might be far away geographically. There may be distance in mileage. You may be far away emotionally and living right down the street. But the distance between you and your father may be extremely great and you may as well be in Alaska, but God, hallelujah, he'll make a way out of no way. He'll make the sun come out after a hurricane, a tornado, or a tsunami. But God can make the crooked place straight. He can make the bumpy, rough place smooth, but God. And you've got to get a but God in your spirit and get yourself to the point that says, no matter what he says, and that's what the young fellow put in his eye. He said, Daddy, look here, I'm back and I'm no more worthy to be your son. Make me like one of the slaves, the servants, the hired servant. I just work. How about that? If you let me come home, I just work. I just work around the house. And his father came running up the road to meet him while he was a long way off and a long way off. He got a robe to put on him. He got a ring to put on him. He told him, cut the calf, get the party ready. My son, my child, who was dead is now alive again. My son, who was lost, who I used to have to get up in the morning, didn't know where he was, went to bed at night, didn't know where he was, is alive again. Start the music. Crank up the band. Start the fire. Get the barbecue going. Hallelujah! It's time to thank the Lord for the great thing that he's done. You can't stop a father from loving his child. And so, thanks be to God. And with all the twists and turns that life can take on this Father's Day, my prayer is you can get to the land of it don't matter no more. You can get to a place where what has happened simply is a powerful testimony. And you look forward to what is about to happen because God is a blessing. God is a wonder to your sanctified soul. Are you listening? Can you hear me? Do you understand? By the grace of God, we call it done. Amen. Amen. Let the church say amen. Let the women and the children say amen. Let the brothers say amen. Amen means it is just like we said it is. God bless you. Listen, I want you to come to Christ. When you come out of sin and confusion and difficulty and hurt and anger and all those crazy things that might make up your faraway experience, your pig pen experience, your embarrassment. When you get through that and you survive that, you can come to a safe place, a sanctuary. It's the place where God the Father controls and he sees you while you're still out there. And when your heart and your footsteps come toward home, he comes to meet you while you're still a long way off. He opens his arm and he says these words, welcome home. Hallelujah. Oh, bless the Lord. And so welcome home to you. Right now, not after a while, not later on, pray with me. Father, in Jesus' name, my life is changing. I feel it. Please, clean me. I've been trying to do it myself and I have not been successful. Wash me. Make me whole. Straighten me out. Get me together. Give me another chance. I'm sorry. I embarrassed myself, my family. I know I broke your heart. But somewhere I heard that you forgive sin. Please forgive mine. Take me home. Your name is Jesus. I call your name Jesus. Take me home. Amen. If you prayed the prayer, you got the blessing. It's just that simple. God wouldn't make it complicated when you've already been through a whole bunch of changes. Just fall on over into the grace of God right now. Amen. Welcome home. Listen, if you're already a part of the family at Love Center Atlanta, or if you are falling in love with what is happening as you watch Sunday morning and you watch Wednesday for Bible study, or maybe you get up early in the morning and you see too early in the morning, the inspiration that's designed just help you get your day started and make you think a little bit differently than maybe something that happened had you thinking. Whatever it is, you support it. Find a way to be a blessing. Amen? I'm calling on you to do that. Lift that seed to the Lord, not as a debt I owe, but as a seed I sow. I won't eat my seed anymore. Hallelujah. God bless you. It's been a blessing to be with you. I'm thankful for it. I think we may have a little bit more, a few more treats to see before we end our Father's Day celebration. I love you. May the grace of God be in your life. I hope you have a beautiful day, something to celebrate. And you know what? This might be the first step of your journey back towards something beautiful. Hold on. Push replay. Maybe you need to watch this word again, lift you up and encourage you, but don't give up, don't quit. And now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest with you and rule over your life, abide with you until we come together, meet again. Let all God's people, let us say amen.